Hi, my name is Taya Leone, and you may know me as Elizabeth McCord on the CBS drama Madam Secretary. Just like my character on the show, I believe deeply in the power in each of us to have a positive effect on the lives of others. And that's what Every 3 Seconds is all about. You're about to meet two regular people, a little boy and a grandmother, who are doing simple yet powerful things to help end hunger and suffering around the world. Charlie has done so much to help UNICEF, an organization very near and dear to my heart, that does whatever it takes to save and protect the world's most vulnerable children. And Gloria, through her work with the Society of St. Andrew, is feeding thousands by picking up leftover fruit and vegetables on America's fields. I hope you will watch their incredible stories and then decide what you can do to end hunger and suffering around the world. Enjoy the movie.
Did you know that hunger and extreme poverty are totally solvable?
Yes, it's solvable, but you're always gonna have an obstacle. How do you get rid of corruption?
I personally hate to think of that it's even out there. So it's like, you kind of put it to the back of your head, or, oh, that can't be true. Even though they say it's true, it can't be true.
Every 3 seconds, one person dies.
Another 3 seconds.
One more.
It is unacceptable that a third of the children in the developing world have brains much smaller than they're supposed to be and bodies stunted simply because they didn't get enough nutrients as a child, when we know how to solve it.
Most of the social problems we have, we know how to solve. There's no question about it. It's about resources and resolve.
We're taught to look down on people who are acting for change.
If you were Miss America, what would you do to make the world a better place?
As Miss America, I would try and bring an end to world hunger.
A lot of people focus on the size of the problem rather than what difference they can make.
If individuals get together, you can change just about anything you want to change.
There's a blinding potential in each of us to have an impact. The ability for each of us to be able to contribute and be part of the solution. This is the wave that's happening now.
That joy and that peace and that goodness that you get, it just overpowers.
There's always cynics out there. There's always people who are gonna question your motivation.
Most of the things in the world that were worth doing were deemed impossible before they were done. Abolish slavery? It's been woven into the fabric of human existence since the dawn of time. Give women the vote? Drop the work week from 80 hours to a 40-hour week, overthrow segregation, overthrow apartheid, overthrow Mubarak dictatorship in Egypt? Impossible.
And what's amazing that's happening right now is that because of mobile phones, because of information technology, because of broadband in villages, we can now monitor the delivery of systems in ways that were unimaginable just a few years ago.
I actually believe in the possibilities of change. It takes a lot, it takes a willingness. It only takes our own willingness to end poverty. And if we are willing, we will, and we shall.
I am Gloria Henderson, and I am 68. I love the idea of being able to give. I feel like that's my calling.
Growing up, she was always busy, always doing stuff for others, always cooking, making homemade breads, and if she could give it away, she would give it away. She was a great mom. Still is. Bakes cakes every year for my birthday. So, yes, we've got a close relationship, me and my mom.
It's a pretty hat.
Thank you, thank you. I like you.
If it was any other color but pink, I'd take it.
Oh, my goodness. My childhood days. I remember my mom working, my dad working. And my grandmother kept all the grandkids. Those were good years. We didn't have a doll baby, but not to have what many people have, we thought we were doing fine.
I've always known my mom as being a community worker, whether it was helping children or education. I think she does it for her love of people, and if there's a need, she wants to help supply.
Oh, Daddy. Grandma still got a little bit of strength, right?
The past couple of years, economics and where we live and location, food has been a big part of what we do.
Oh, a lot of years ago.
My mom is like the coordinator. She talks with the actual farmers. She makes sure that there's people, men and women, here to bag it. Then she goes out and delivers.
Hi, Miss Gloria.
Hey,
how are you? Nice to
see
you
this morning.
We serve from 400 to 500 people every day, Monday to Friday. We don't get any donation of fresh produce except Miss Gloria bring it to us. So the fresh produce is really healthy for them.
Nobody wants to do cleaning. But I just love it.
The people who take stands and often make change are not born 20 feet tall. They're ordinary people. They have families, they have jobs, they have every pressure that all the rest of us, that everyone has.
I think all of us, we all have a need to be connected and part of something larger than ourselves.
Hello.
Fight now.
Charlie.
Kids!
Yeah.
Shush!
Hey!
Charlie came first, baby number one. Oh, he was sweet, wasn't he?
I'm sure he was like most babies are, but as a parent, you kind of, you think your kid's different.
His little sister came along 15 months after, Alice. She's a very strong character, determined, isn't she?
She was showing signs of early genius when she was a baby. But then all parents say that, I'm sure.
No.
Ah!
That was a snail, Charlie.
That was what you were eating. A wee snaily.
I'm called Charlie. I am 8, and when I did the bike ride, I was 7.
Charlie is a bit of a drama queen, and I think he has such a mix of stuff going on in him. He's a pretty complex character.
I like history, I like design and technology, and I like English.
Over to your right side.
He'll be rough and tumble and nasty to his sister and, you know, rude to us, like any kid is going to be. But then at the heart of him is this real soft, soft side, and he will immediately empathise, won't he?
I think his compassionate side is something that's very much part of his personality.
If I can't find anything else except this, I'm probably going to be a paleontologist. They dig up dinosaur bones.
How did you first find out about the earthquake in Haiti?
Well, I saw it on TV and stuff like that, and I thought, well, I've got to do something about it.
The seismic energy of the 7-magnitude earthquake is the same as 32,000 small atomic bombs.
I think Charlie became aware was because we were watching the news about it.
Power has been out since it happened. Most houses have fallen.
Charlie became very upset by it when the pictures of the children in real hardship started coming on TV because Charlie's always shown a lot of empathy. I mean, literally, floods
crying
of tears, really upset.
I remember seeing lots of children, actually. Lots of them were stuck, lots of them were, all of them were homeless, and lots of them had lost their mum and dad. so it's quite sad.
I just remember saying to him, well, you can't just sit there and be sad about it. If you feel strongly about it, you need to, you know, do something. You can't just say, oh, that's dreadful. You need to get off your backside and do whatever you think will help. But just sitting there crying isn't the way forward.
Deidre.
My mom started out with just us, and now there's about 9 different congregations that do it. So it's like planting a seed and watching it grow. And it's gotten bigger and bigger and bigger.
We're waiting on the Marines that's supposed to be ready at 5:15, but praise the Lord, we got a little time. I have people from all walks of life who want to go. I don't refuse anybody. They say they want to help. Don't tell me that, because I eventually will get around to you.
Amen. Amen.
Beautiful people, you live in the same world as I do, but somehow I never noticed you before today. I'm ashamed to say.
Hey, Bill, we are running about a half hour behind schedule. We have to wait for the Marines. We got about 16 or 20 of them.
A national anti-hunger organization is reviving an ancient practice to feed the poor, gleaning.
Food gets left in the field for all kinds of reasons. Mechanical harvesting misses a lot. Sometimes the crops aren't pretty enough for supermarket shelves.
The statistics are that 96 billion pounds of food goes to waste in this country.
Leave the white bags back when you get through now. We want to work till we fill up all the trucks, not just one truck, all of them. Sometimes in the harvesting process, they drop some on the ground and they cut like the top of the stalk. But then there's the lower part of that corn stalk that still has corn on it.
My name is Lettuce Raspberry. I married the raspberry. I'm 91 years old. I showed her how to pick up sweet potatoes and put them in the barn, and I didn't have to buy no sweet potatoes. She started picking up potatoes and going to give them to some of her friends, and from there, we'll see where she is now.
Thank you. Many people say, is hunger ever winnable? There was a big, huge effort in the 1970s. If we actually look at the numbers, we have cut the proportion of hunger in half since 1969. Nation after nation after nation has beat the hunger trap. Just over 100 years ago, Swedish farmers lived on dirt floors and were so poor, they weren't sure they could eat. The United States in the 1960s launched a battle against malnutrition because half the recruits in World War II came in malnourished.
Despite the fact that the world's population is growing, a smaller number of people are dying from poverty-related causes, not just a smaller percentage, but a smaller number. And if we were to put in more resources, we could make a lot more progress.
Will the poor keep getting hungry and the rich keep getting fat? Politicians change, but they're never gonna change that. But you and me, girl, we got the answer right in our hands. All we gotta do is
we conspire in our own defeat by letting ourselves off the hook on an issue like global hunger. We conspire in our own defeat by letting our elected leaders off the hook. I'm not suggesting that we all give up everything we have, although certainly many of us could give up something. But at least to let a glimmer in of recognition of what it is like to live in a situation that's desperate and changeable. And that's the hinge. Because, of course, if it's unchangeable, then we don't have a responsibility.
I mean, everybody was moved by what happened in Haiti. And it's like whenever you get one of these disasters that hits the global media, everybody thinks, well, I'm going to donate some money to that. You know, everybody's got the best of intentions, but a lot of people
don't actually...
A lot of people don't get around to doing it just because we're all busy people.
Well, I said to my mum, what can I do? Can I do a bike ride? And she said, yeah, and then I put up a web page.
Year before, I'd done a sponsored bike ride, and I think you maybe thought that was the only way you raised money was by doing sponsored bike rides.
Go.
Children often know more than we think they do. So they're aware of it. They're aware of war and hunger and desperation, and it hurts them. They haven't developed the sophisticated denial mechanisms, the sophisticated filters that we have in all our years. When they have the opportunity to do something, even in a simple way, I think they leap into it.
Kids have an instinct to help, right? One-year-olds will help somebody in need. And so we have to make that a practice, like the great ethical religious traditions did, is to engage in the needs of others and the suffering of others.
Charlie was motivated by seeing the other kids in Haiti, so we wanted a charity that was going to benefit other kids.
UNICEF is an organization that's basically for children, for life. So we're about ensuring that children have their rights to education, to health, to water, to all of the things that basically make them survive and thrive wherever they are in the world. Over many years, UNICEF has talked about the scandal of poverty. And I think that's one of the most powerful things about what Charlie did is he said, that's wrong, it's not just sad, it's wrong, and we can do something about it.
Daddy! Daddy, stop it!
I genuinely thought when we said his total was £500, I genuinely thought we weren't gonna get anywhere close to that.
Yeah.
I felt embarrassed sending out an email to work colleagues.
We all did, but...
So when Leo put the target at £500, I was thinking, this is a recipe for disaster, he's going to be disappointed.
I think what happened is my dad sent it to everyone at work and all his friends, and then they probably passed it to all their friends and all their friends and all their friends.
I don't know what it was about the story that made people just forward it on. It's very strange, but it seemed to capture people's imaginations.
Yeah.
You know, within the first few hours, the amount of money that Charlie was raising just started to grow and grow very, very quickly. And it went from just a few £100 to a few £1,000s. And then obviously people began to sit up and take notice and think there's something quite exceptional going on here.
Charlie was unaware of what was going on
during
the fundraising.
Because he was at school all day. And I kind of knew, obviously, and I was like, okay. I didn't say anything because I wanted him to see it for himself.
Ooh, I made some money.
That was the target. Raised.
So far. £2.
£2.
It's not a full stop, is it?
£2,000.
£2,555!
Yay! He just leapt off his stool, he was punching the air. It was just over the moon.
So what does that mean, Charlie? All that money, where's it going?
To Haiti.
To Haiti. What was it going to do in Haiti?
Make Daddy, homes.
Tell it. Make Daddy, tell Daddy.
Make homes in Haiti and feed water, mostly.
We did 17,500 pounds today, and that's about 68,000 meals. I'm feeling tired physically, but spiritually, I'm enthused and I'm happy.
It makes you feel good that you give this amount of food away. You know there's some people out there that are hungry, and it's going to the food banks to feed people. So it makes you feel, gives you a good feeling inside.
More corn, please.
We've all had this experience when, in moments of charity, in moments of community, something comes over our bodies, literally. What is that? And now we have a rock-solid science that is finding when I am connecting to the needs of somebody else, a bundle of nerves called the vagus nerve is activated. It starts at the top of your spinal cord. The nerves wander through your throat, help you vocalize and look at people and orient your body towards others. It drops down into your chest and then uses respiration to slow your heart rate. Then the vagus nerve keeps going, drops down into your digestive organs, and then recent studies suggest that it's also connecting to your immune system. That is activated when I respond to other people in need and when I act upon that. That's remarkable.
I think it's important from an early age to encourage your child to have a social conscience. He said, I want to raise some money for charity. It can't do any harm. Why wouldn't you encourage it? Why wouldn't you say, great, we'll do it. If you raise £5, fantastic. If you raise £250,000, wow, that's amazing.
UNICEF contacted us because they suddenly saw this little kid bringing in all this money.
What are you hoping to raise?
I was hoping £500, but we got more than £20,000.
How much? £20,000?
More than £20,000.
More than £20,000 is extraordinary.
Whilst we were on the sofa at Sky chatting, we were told that it had gone up to 30. And we were sitting there just going, oh, my God, what is going on? And it was just crazy.
It's really quite remarkable.
Did you hear that, Charlie? Yeah. Already, yeah. £30,000.
Charlie did two things. One, he reached out with his heart. He saw children in Haiti and said, actually, that's not OK. I want to do something about that. But by doing that, he also reached out and touched the hearts of people here.
Lots of people came to cheer me on. Lots of people with cameras.
Well, Charlie's initial target was just £500, but thanks to the internet, donations have been coming in from all over the world.
I saw the pictures on TV and I thought it was really sad, so I just wanted to, you know.
You wanted to do something, yeah. Didn't you?
It's quite tiring, but I just kept on going.
His friend Zach did it with him, which was brilliant.
Yeah, Zach volunteered him to give him a bit of moral support.
Alice and Zach's little sister held the final ribbon so that when Charlie had finished the 5 miles, they let it go. It was lovely, actually. They had a ball. It was fun.
And Charlie was just over the moon when he finished. He was so happy to be off the bike.
I feel quite happy once I did it and proud of myself.
And then the next morning, he was on the front cover of the Daily Mirror. Very weird seeing your child on the front page of a national newspaper.
I thought, oh my gosh.
You could go on his webpage and you could click refresh and it would, the total would be jumping up in thousands in the time it took for the page to refresh.
Total is now over £87,000 after it got highlighted online.
Last count, Charlie had raised almost $160,000.
Generosity and altruism really are viral. The spread of goodness. It's this underappreciated but very reliable thing that happens in human communities.
There's lots of evidence that the more people are aware that others are giving, the more likely they are to give themselves.
Now let's speak to Katie Harrison from UNICEF.
Good morning.
It's just extraordinary amount of money.
Incredible. We're all so proud of him and so grateful to him for his support. It's just amazing. He's already raised enough to provide 7,000 children with clean and fresh water. We're very proud of him.
I'm Simon, this is Alice, this is Charlie. Read what Charlie's got on his T-shirt. Please donate, because Charlie's in charge.
He couldn't quite understand why Simon Cowell wanted to meet him, so he said to Simon Cowell, he said, why did you want to meet me? And he said, because you're the most famous boy in the world, which at the time felt like quite a throwaway comment. I reflect on this a couple of days later when we knew for a fact that he'd been in the papers in North America, South America,
Asia.
Australia, South Africa.
We were just, whoa.
And it dawned on me then that what Simon Cowell had actually said was, for a couple of days, probably
true.
Right. He probably was the most famous boy in the world for sort of 48 hours. thankfully, it only lasted 48 hours.
Yeah.
Oh, a spider and dinosaur.
It all got so big so quickly that at that stage I was like, whoa, this is too big and really a little bit scary. And, you know, with all this attention, it was really crazy.
You nervous about everything?
Not yet.
But you are going to be, right?
I have a reason to be.
I guess everybody's going to be just smiling and grinning at you. then you're gonna be even more excited, right?
She's a great sister, and I love her to death. I'm quite proud of her, yeah. We came a long ways.
Can't you feel it in your bones? A change is coming on.
Ladies and gentlemen, it is my honor to present to you Mrs. Gloria Henderson, who will receive the Humanitarian of the Year Award.
We achieve redemption not through isolation, but engagement, not from withdrawing from the world, but through connecting with other people to try and make this a better world to pass on.
I'm looking out at your faces, beautiful people. There are 36 million Americans who go hungry. And let us do something about that. People who don't help people are really missing out on something, because there is an inner peace, there is a joy there, and then it increases your blessings.
Charlie raised over £250,000 for Haiti, but it doesn't make him any more special than some kid who raised £20 selling lemonade outside their house. Good is not measured by the amount of money you raise, it's just being motivated to do something, so.
Yeah, it's really important.
Yeah.
It wasn't just about Charlie raised all this money, but other kids could see he was this kid like them who was into computer games and had to go to school and do his homework just like they did, doing something, and it made a difference.
And I've been proud of him all through his life. But that was a little window of his life of overwhelming pride.
You can be the one person who makes that difference in another person's life. We each have in our life stories, always is a story in which there is one person who showed up in the right moment, who made it possible for us to go to another step in our life.
People helping people, that's my lifestyle.
Do you ever feel like a plastic bag? Drifting through the wind, wanting to start again. Do you ever feel this so paper thin? Like a house of cards, one blow from caving in. Do you ever feel...
Gleaning keeps me very young.
6 feet under screens and no one seems to hear a thing. Do you know that there's still a chance for you? Cause there's a spark in you. You just gotta ignite the light.
A pack of five could kill two T-Rex.
Okay, now it's your turn. What can you do to help someone who isn't as fortunate as you are? Can you help raise money for an important cause like Charlie? Or can you help feed the hungry in your neighborhood? Remember, neither Charlie nor Gloria started out with big ideas. Both of them simply wanted to help a few people. How would you like to help? Go to every3seconds.org for more ideas, and then take action You never know. You might just change the world.